we need to operate at 98% production capacity. And once again, forgive my handwriting, this is as good as it gets. A lot of this is driven around your need to have enough volume to cover your fixed costs, those costs that are always there no matter what you do. And also to help you afford your variable costs. Like labor is usually variable costs, raw materials are variable. That means that the greater your volume, the greater of sales, the greater volume you're going to need of plastics for the toys, things for the toys, the greater need for human resources to make it and everything. So, any thoughts on that, especially when you get into commodity, daily type items, companies usually need to have their plants running at a good capacity. Now, they're also going to want to make a profit. And yes, they want a profit, but they also need this usage rate to be very high. I mean, it's not like sometimes you say we want one and not the other. You usually need both of them. The one thing about strategy planning is to always think, regardless of what you're trying to achieve, if you're trying to achieve profits, if you're trying to achieve growth, if you're trying to achieve capacity utilization, market share. Sometimes market share is more important than growth and profitability. I'll give you a real life example. When I was in the chemical industry, I'll bring that phosphoric acid back up one more time. At that time, there was only four producers in the U.S. on that chemical. And we basically all had 25% market share. One of our main goals was to maintain, plus or minus a little bit, we wanted to maintain 25% market share. Because with only having four producers in the United States of this product, and this product is used in everything in America to some form or fashion. It's used in not just soft drinks, but detergents, goes into some food additives, et cetera, et cetera. I could go on all day and hear what it's used in. This product has 25% share for each company. If we were to have been aggressive, and by the nature of doing a great job, we started getting around 30% market share, we would have had a legal trouble because we were an oligopoly. Now, like a monopoly means you're like one person that controls an industry, one company or one person that controls an industry. That's a monopoly. An oligopoly is very few producers that control the market. So there was just four of us. That's very few. In a huge market that sold products throughout the world, we had as a goal that 25% market share. And if we actually started getting more share, we would sometimes have to focus on how to reduce some of our customers because it would bring our share too high. We also would not let our volume go or share go below a certain number because that meant our production capacity of our plants was lowering. So instead of operating at a 98% capacity, if we lost a couple percent market share, we might fall down to 90% capacity. And that made a total difference in profit versus loss. Because at a 90% capacity, we were barely covering our fixed costs. 98%, we were covering fixed, whole, variable. We were covering all our costs and having something left over. So growth and profits are things that are part of goals, and it should be part of your goals. And they typically are a driver around strategic planning. But all I'm wanting you to start today's discussion thinking about is the concept of strategic planning. The word strategic in itself means long term. I mean, it's strategic, it's important, it's guiding you, it's something for the long term. It's where you want to head for the long term. So in strategic planning, all you're doing is making a plan that will help you achieve your strategic goals. Those goals will be long term. And sometimes they'll be profit, sometimes they'll be growth, sometimes they'll be market share. There's different things that they could be. But just think in terms of as today's conversation begins, marketing exists in the framework of the world. In the environment, like we talked about in our first session. So what we're going to do is take today is that, okay, now we have this environment in which a company operates and exists, and we're going to figure out why and how a company can develop a plan to help them achieve their goals. So we go to the next slide. Okay. Some people talk about marketing strategies, some about marketing plans. It's all the same thing. I'll put this slide in today's discussion to let you know some of the words that you'll hear from various people. Some people will say marketing strategies. Some people will say marketing plan. Some will say business plan. But if you really come down to it, they're all basically just different words that mean the same thing. If I say, what is your business plan for your company? I'm asking you, how and what will you do to reach your goals? That's the same thing with marketing plan. What is it you want to do, and how are you going to do it? Strategic plan, same thing. What do you want to achieve, how are you going to do it? That's all a marketing plan is really, or strategic plan is doing in essence. It's fundamentally saying to you, what do you want to achieve, and how do you think you can achieve that goal that you have? That is the whole fundamental underlying today's discussion of one of the most important topics in marketing is marketing strategy. Because firms have found that if they want to achieve their success, if they want to grow, they want to have bigger companies, they want to do the right things, they've got to have some goals or targets. It's the same in your own personal life. If you're going through life without some personal targets, things you want to achieve, you're really going to end up just kind of waddling through life. You need goals, and that's the same in business. What are your goals, and how are you going to reach them? That's the essence of the marketing plan. So if we go to the next slide. Okay. When you're writing a marketing plan, there are certain things that you're going to be needing to look for. What are your expected goals, expected performance? Do you have expectations that your profits are going to increase 10%, 5%? Do you have expectations that you'll have a 15% market share or a 5% market share? A marketing plan lets you, it expects you, it demands that you develop these goals so that as you're implementing the marketing plan, as your company has said, these are our goals and these are the things we're going to achieve those goals, it now gives you something to come back and compare your efforts to. You know, we had XYZ goals for growth, profitability, market share, capacity utilization. We had this plan in order to achieve those goals. Now you want to come back at some point, and usually fairly early in the game, and start looking at the results that you're achieving to see if you're on target with where you want to head. If you wait 5 years to compare it, you may have cost yourself too much money and not achieve your goals. But a marketing strategy, the fact that it gives you those goals, is going to give you something to compare to. Bear with me. Have a question. Really good question. From Teresa. Teresa, very pragmatic question. Teresa asked, who polices companies that are oligopolies? What is the punishment or fine for having too much of the market share, and how does it apply? That's a really good question. And I'm sitting here now thinking of the government organization. There's an organization of fair trade that operates the fair trade laws. It used to be the Federal Trade Commission and their fair trade laws are who controls the oligopolies. Punishment, it depends on the crime. If you have for example, been having too much market share in the FTC's view year after year after year. When they come and catch what you're doing, they may give you some serious fines. But if you've made some accidents and didn't realize that you were over the edge a little bit, now sometimes they just kind of smack you on the hand. It really depends on you. Now, like in our case, this is where we will talk about contextualities. That's one of the reasons this question is great. Is in our case, we had a division that did business within the Defense Department. So we were tied very much with the government for two ways. One, we had the market share limitation based on antitrust laws and federal trade commission policies and everything that said we can't have over 25% market share. And I just lost my whole train of thought. Sorry about that. And on the other hand, we had this division that manufactures military thing. They made personnel carriers that are used in wars. And the threat that we had was if we did not shape up our market share on phosphoric acid, we had been in the business forever since the product was invented. We were the inventors of it. And since we had been in the industry so long, had so much experience, knew the laws for so long, and they were able to see that we had sometimes, off and on, had to have market share, they came to us and said, okay, we'll give you a warning. If you don't hit this reduced market share goal within 6 months, you will lose your military business with the government. 100% of it. That military business was 1/4 of our total corporate business. So $1 out of every $4 we took in as a company was for the military. So in this case, it could have been so severe that if we did not hit the market share goals that the FTC set for us, we were going to lose 25% of our business, which meant shutting down plants, laying off people, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It could be really nasty. So, you know, there's contextualities about how big you are, how much you should know, how much you do know. Have you done things that the FTC thinks that you've played with the laws a little bit or something and trying to get away murder? It depends a little bit. They have the discretion. The FTC has the discretion as to what the punishment would be. Okay, Michael. What you were describing in regards to four companies, each having a 25% market share, and each not able or willing to gain more share, could sound like price fixing. I know this is a bit off topic, but I wonder how this arrangement works. Well, that's a great question, Michael, and I thank you for asking it. That is great, and that is so pragmatic. That was something else we had to be very careful about. And you run into this in different industries, not just the chemical industry. You run into this with some of the technology industries. Intel ran into this one time in terms of price fixing. Some different companies in different industries have been charged for price fixing over the years. When we set our pricing, we obviously always had to base it around what we assumed the competition would do. So if we were selling something for, let's say, 34 cents a pound, and we're starting to renew contracts for next year, and we really want 40 cents a pound to increase our profits, say right now 34 cents, we're barely surviving, but if we get to 40 cents a pound, we're making a good profit. We have to figure out what's the competition going to do. Have their actions indicated they're after market share? If yes, that means you're going to have a lower price. Or are the reasons in the market that you and the others are going to all try to increase your pricing? That's something you just have to use your judgment on as you go through the business world. It is extremely risky. Don't ever get into price fixing, no matter who you are, how big you are in the industry. If you're ever found to be price fixing, you can be shut down very fast. We weren't found for that. But we always had to make sure that it did not appear that we were price fixing. That was one of our responsibilities. We made sure our pricing and market shares and actions that we took, that would be things as basic as memos inside the company. If we were sending memos to each other that talked about pricing, know, someone might misinterpret it. Someone may very innocently say, based on what I'm hearing in the market from customers, it appears to me that competitor A is going to increase their pricing by 5%. Thus, I feel that that gives us the opportunity to increase ours by 5%. In that case, you've done nothing but use market knowledge to develop a price, a logical price, that would fit the market's needs and everything. You know it's totally innocent. Someone else can read this note and interpret it as prices. So it just takes a lot of skills and a lot of time to make sure you're not captured or caught for price fixing if you're not doing it. Because that can take you down, take your company down. Just be careful. And I hope that makes sense. If I haven't answered it properly, Michael, let me know. The one thing in your marketing plan that's mandatory, I don't care if you use the word marketing plan, marketing strategy, business plan, business strategy, I don't care what word you use. One of the first things that you need to do are figure out your goals. Okay. If you don't take time to figure out your goals, and we're going to talk in a few slides later about how to figure out what your goals are, there's specific activities you can take to set your goals. If you don't start with goals, you don't know what you're going to do. But I guarantee you, you have to do things. You have to make price decisions. You have to make production capacity decisions. You have to make human resource decisions. You have to make raw material inventory decisions. You're going to make a lot of decisions that are very, very expensive. Think of the toy producers, think of Mattel. I can't even imagine how much of their sales is tied up in inventory in their warehouses. They got gazillions of dollars of toys in their inventory. All right, well, they need to have a goal for how many toys they're going to sell during the holidays or on an annual basis or whatever to kind of guide that inventory level. If they say, well, the future looks like we're going to be slipping a little market share, then I'm going to be reducing my inventory. I'm going to be watching my human resources. I'm going to make sure we're operating capacity to the best of our ability. So goals kind of give you things to work around. And once you have your goals, you start thinking of the word activities. The activity is nothing more but what are you going to do to achieve your goals. If you have said, we have a goal for 10% market share, we're a new toy company, we have only been in the industry for 2 or 3 years, you know, we're playing with the major ones like Mattel, etc. You know, they're the big dogs in the market. If we can get 10% market share in the next 10 years, that would be great. That would be awesome for us to do it. All right, how do we go about getting 10% market share? Well, that may be a price issue. You may have to reduce your pricing. That doesn't mean you do have to. It just means you might have to. It may mean you have to promote your products a certain way. You may have to say to some of the retailers, for every unit you buy, I'll give you 50% off the next unit. The strategies will vary, but you have to have a goal to guide your strategies of what you're going to do. Throughout your whole process of doing, developing a strategy plan, setting your goals, having your activities lined up to help you achieve those goals, and typically most companies think in terms of 2 to 5 years as their goals. Companies used to think in terms of 10 years, but because we're in such a competitive world anymore, they're thinking in 2 to 5 years. You want to be examining, monitoring, watching what is going on. If you say, we have right now a 1% market share, and we want to go to 10% market share in 10 years, okay, That means every year I need this 1% to be growing. I'm not going to magically go from 1% year 1 to 10% year 10 or year 5 or whichever. It's going to be a gradual, slow growth. Does you have that? If you've got this 5-year, 10-year strategy plan that lays out what you want to achieve in terms of volume or market share or profit in year 1, then year 2, then year 3, then year 4, you better come back year 1, year 2, year 3, year 4, and examine what have been your results. Compare those to what your goals were to see if you're on the right direction or not. One thing some companies, and it's typically smaller companies, because usually the big companies have learned these lessons, is if you don't periodically challenge yourself and say, I wanted to go from 1% to 10% within this time period, so that means year 2, I want 2%, year 3, I want 3%, year 4, I want 4%. You can really monitor that and see if you're doing it or not. And you may come back every 6 months. You may come back once a year and examine what is actually happening in the market compared to those goals for the purpose of going back and saying, are we using the right activities? Are we doing the right things? Are we pricing properly? Are we promoting and advertising properly? Yeah, are we manufacturing properly? You know, if we have some manufacturing problems that affects quality, that's going to affect, impact volume quite a bit. Research. Sometimes research may be a way to help you find new products to help you make that will achieve new market growth or whatever. Just remember, you've got within this plan, you've got to have these goals. And you don't just go, I want to be here today. 10 years, sorry, I learned how the TV works. And in 10 years, I want to be there. So I'll come back in 10 years and see what we've done. You could have destroyed your company many times over in that process. You've got to monitor what is going on, evaluating it, examining it, challenging yourself. That means challenging manufacturing, quality, everything, shipping. You have to challenge it to make sure that you're on track with your goals. If you're not reaching the intermediate goals, like after year 1, year 2, then you're not going to reach the long-term goals. So then you have to think this way. Nick has a great question. Do you have contingency plans that will kick in if the strategies are doing poorly or exceeding expectations? For example, if you reach 10% before the year 10, do I have a strategy backup? I think that is a really, really good question, and I thank you for it very much. Absolutely. Absolutely. You've got to have backup plans. That's one of the reasons. You've got to do this comparison along the way. What's happening to what you've planned? Usually when a company makes a strategic plan. Think in terms of, especially for this class, I would ask you to maybe make a 5-year strategic plan maybe in your project. And it's not unusual. A lot of major companies have 5-year strategic plans, but in that they come back once every year in the meantime and evaluate what's happening to see if they're getting where they want to go on a continual basis out there. Usually when you develop your strategic plan is when you immediately start thinking of backups. And for example, you may say, well, our goal is to have a 10% market share in year 10. Now, what if we don't have 10%? What if we end up with 5%? What do we do at that point? Do we reduce manufacturing capacity? Do we lay off employees at that point? On the other hand, let's have a backup plan that says, well, year 10 occurs, and we blown the socks off the competition. We're at a 20% market share. We didn't dream we'd get that big, but we did. up front, you probably should have had a plan and said, if we start doing that, what will we do? Will we add capacity? Will we just add new plants? Because sometimes you can take a current plant and expand it. Sometimes you have to build a new plant. Sometimes you can hire one or two more salespeople. Sometimes you have to have another sales force. I mean, there's different things you can do to make contingencies. And that's why your question is so great. That's another reason why you really need to, every 6 months to a year, come back, re-examine what is occurring as compared to what your goals were. And that gives you a constant state of questioning yourself. And it's not negative. I don't believe that's a negative term at all. It puts you in a constant state of monitoring your business to make sure that the strategies that you've been using are correct, or if you need some of these backups. Because you might have said, well, our backup is, if we do not achieve that 1% market share growth each year, every year for 10 years, then by the year 3 and 4, we're going to make the decision not to expand capacity or something. Or we may lay off 10% of the workforce. Depends on the situation, but you're totally right. You should have backup contingency plans. Michael. I may ask you to hold off on this, but Michael, it's good. Would you agree that a strategic plan could be brief so long as it is measurable and time specific? And that the balance of the work are action items, and those will probably be many and varied. Yeah, can I say that, Michael? I want to say that when we come back to it. Only because your question ties right into the discussion I'll have fairly soon, just a few slides in the future. And we will definitely be getting to that topic. So if I could, let's save that one. Because that was so pragmatic, but if I do it now, then when we get to the slide, it'll have no value for anybody. Okay, can we go to the slide 5, I think it is. Bear with me while you're not like, okay. We're starting to get into Michael's question. What you're looking at, and these slides, I hope I told y'all the first week of the semester, but if I didn't, forgive me. All the slides that I'm using each week are posted on your Blackboard. The way I get these slides is the company that makes the book will give us a disk that has questions that can be used in exams or quizzes, case studies that can be used, slides that you can use in presentation. It's not unusual for a company to send 70 and 80 slides for one chapter and say these 70, 80, 90 slides are for chapter 2. What I do every beginning of every semester is I go slowly through the slides for each chapter and call it down to the ones that I think really matter. I don't want you to try to read 90 slides. You'll never get the messages. I'd rather have a few slides, 5, 6, 7, I think today's about 10, and get some real good points out of it. So that's where the slides came from. The slides are based on the book discussion, plus we're tying our class discussion into them. So feel free to use these in your study for the exam, because this will kind of give you a general framework of what you might expect, also multiple choice. I'm not going to ask you a lot of questions around things that we haven't covered. Basically, what we're going to do now, and this is going to go back to Michael, what is in a marketing plan, and how do you make one? Okay. Step A. We've all heard the phrase mission plan. This is a statement. And some of them, I've seen some companies have business missions that were one sentence. And I've seen some where their mission statement is like sentence after sentence after sentence, or maybe like paragraphs. My belief, and I can tie this into a personal experience I had with a company in Wisconsin when I left FMC, I worked for a private owned chemical company. And they really did not have a mission statement in terms of what are they? What are they? What kind of company are they? And it probably took us 6 months of analyzing the market, manufacturing, customer, everything, to be able to say what we are. Now this one, that example has a meaning for you, so I'll use IBM. IBM, Big Blue, for decades and decades and decades, you know, it was Big Blue. It was as gold chip as you can get in the investment industry. I mean, if you bought IBM, you were guaranteed to have good dividends and guaranteed to have the price of the stock go up year after year. It was like that until you started getting into the 80s, the late 80s. And you started having this explosion, late 80s, more like the 90s, where you started having this explosion of new technology companies. Little companies called Dell, Apple, Hewlett-Packard, you know, those little companies out there that started making something called a laptop. Okay. IBM perceived itself as a computer company, flat out. The next thing you know, the 90s roll around and they're losing their market share like crazy. Because small companies, for example, were finding out, I don't need to buy a small PC unit for my office. I can just get a laptop and it'll do everything I need. Then individual people did it. Then little larger businesses did it. So IBM started losing a lot of business to these laptops, Dell, Hewlett-Packard, Apple, etc. Then they started losing volume. They started losing profit. They started going into a panic mode. And they actually did, I think, about a 6 month market analysis, competitive analysis, self-analysis, to really say, what are we missing? What's happening? And they really finally came out and said, what's missing for us is the fact that we're not a computer company. We are an information technology company. That completely changed their business strategies. Once they made that little minor thing. So a mission can be as simple as saying, this is what kind of company I am. Now, a lot of companies like to say, we're going to operate effectively, efficiently, profitably, love our employees will love us, the market we're going to love, we're going to take care of society and the environment. And you end up with this mission, and you're sitting there thinking, so what are you? The mission is nothing more than a statement of what you are as a company. Okay, if Luna has a question. The textbook recommends having a broad, definable mission statement for the business. But if you are marketing a specific product, wouldn't the mission statement need to be more specific? Is this where SBUs, strategic business units, come into play? Would a specific mission statement be for an SBU? Pragmatic question. Well, that's really great questions. This is the first time we ever taught a distance learning class. I can't believe what great questions you all come out with. I mean, they're really logical and pragmatic and really real world questions. I'm not a believer in this, it's just me. Different people, different companies have different beliefs. I believe, yes, keep it simple. I mean, the simpler you run your business, and I don't mean not checking things out and not having thought things out, but the simpler your business strategy, the simpler your mission, the simpler your view of yourself, the simpler your goal, a lot of times that increases your chances of being that. Because if you have a mission that's specific and short, and all of your employees are aware of it, everybody understands what you're trying to be as a company. Thus, you have a greater chance of achieving it. If you, and I think one company agreed with it, if you have a mission statement that's this long, and you think, oh, we got a great mission statement, it covers everything, it covers profit, it covers social responsibility, it covers blah, blah, blah. That's great. On the other hand, you run the risk of it being so complex that a lot of your employees won't even understand what it's telling them. So keep I said, keep your business plan, your strategic image of yourself, your mission statement. Keep it simple. And say what it is, what kind of a company are you, and what kind of a company do you want to be to the world? I mean, do you want to say, we are an information technology company who's focused on maximum profitability, at the same time, maximum social responsibility on our part? Do you want to say, we plan on being a toy company for the domestic market, and our mission is to always make sure that our employees are very safe for children, so we're, our business and our retailers and distributors' businesses are dependable, that they don't have to worry about lead and paint and things like that. I mean, you have to figure it out yourself. The simpler, the shorter, the briefer vision statement, the more people are going to get it and figure out what you're doing. So now we're back to Michael's question. Would you agree that a strategic plan could be so brief, so long as it is measurable and time-specific, and that the balance of the work are those actions, those items, and that the plan and that the balance of the work are action items, that those are probably the many and varied? Yes. Bottom line, yes. Have your strategy, your mission, have your strategy very specific, very time-specific, very measurable. And we'll do a couple of slides in just a minute and get into that in detail. The shorter, the simpler, the more specific your plan for your strategies, for your goals, for your action plans, the more specific, the more measurable, the more specific you are, that usually means it's more measurable. If I say, for example, I put up in our strategy plan, our goal is to increase our market share 1% per year for the next 10 years, such that in year 10, we have a 10% market share. Bam. That is so short and simple. Look how measurable that is. That means you're saying, I'll be 1% in year 1, 2% in year 2, 3% of the market share in year 3, et cetera, up to 10%. Think how simple that is. It's great. And it is so measurable. It is extremely measurable. And it's something that if you're getting all firm with, you can come back with corrective actions. So I agree. If you can have something concise, clear, easy to measure, life is going to be a lot easier for the company because everybody knows what you're trying to achieve. In that scenario, think about it. If I said 1% per year for 10 years, so that in year 10 we have a 10% market share, everybody knows what we want to do. That manufacturing, for example. Now, manufacturing starts thinking out, okay, what do we need to do each year for the next 10 years that we can make that volume? Finance needs to say, okay, how do we provide the money for the hiring of additional people, paying of additional advertising, building of new facilities, et cetera, et cetera. How do we get the money to do that? Marketing and sales talk about, you know, how many salespeople do we need year one, year two, year three to keep this growth going? Because for 1% market share, we maybe only need 10 salespeople. If we want a 10% market share, it may be exponential. We may need to have 500 salespeople. There's a company in Mexico, it's a Mexican-based company that a friend of mine in Philadelphia works for, and they sell a product called Zircon in the United States, and it's used in making porcelain. It's added to the mixture, so if you have a porcelain sink or something, the Zircon is what lets it come out as a really smooth finish. That's what does it. And they probably, no, I shouldn't have any numbers, that would be unfair. But the U.S. is a notable percentage of their business, but it's not like 10%. It's just a notable market for them. They have one salesperson in the U.S. that works with all of the major players that make porcelain sinks and things like that, and that's it. I mean, but they know that if their market share goes up anymore, that they're going to have to go to two or three people very quickly. So the simpler, the more measurable, the more easy people understand. The easier it is for people to understand something, the greater their chance of achieving that and helping you hit your goals. So all of your questions were right there in that statement. Yes, simple, easy, concise. Concise is so important. Don't take 100 words to say what you're saying in 10 words. It loses the audience. Use language that everybody understands, such that when your employees and your customers re-look up and look at your mission statement or your strategy plan or whatever, they understand what you're trying to do. I mean, it's just easy. Now that you've got your business mission statement, as if what kind of a business you're going to be. Again, an example. IBM said, we are going to be an information technology business. Now, you need to start setting some goals. This will vary. What are the goals you want to achieve? Are your goals market share? Are they profitability? Are they entering into new markets? Such as, for example, perhaps your business is currently based in the U.S. and all of your business is domestic, but you know to have long-term growth, you want to get into the international market. Thus, that is your goal. Goals guide you. And an objective and a goal, it's the same word. Right? Some people say, well, this is our goal and this is our objective. That's a strategy. You know, why make it so complicated? What kind of company do I want to be? What are my goals? And once I have my goals and I start doing some of these things, before I start saying, what am I going to do? In other words, what are my strategy steps? I don't do that right now. At this point, I've got my mission statement of what kind of business I want to be, our objectives or our goals, what we want to achieve. Now you need to do two things. One, you need to do a SWOT. SWOT, a SWOT analysis. Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Now, obviously, this is going to be in your book very clearly. So go to there to expand your understanding of it, because a SWOT analysis is extremely important. Basically, a SWOT analysis is how your business is perceived as compared to your competition in the eyes of your customers. Strengths. You may say, and a lot of companies jump to say this, you may say, one of our strengths is we make really top quality products. The customer who's out there that may, for example, let's say Walmart. Let's say you make toys. Well, they buy toys from more than one company. And you say, we make really cost-efficient or cost-effective, high-quality toys. They buy from you, they buy from other companies, and they may look at you and go, well, really, compared to your competition, you're not. Because these products are made from another company down in Florida or out of Mexico or wherever. Yeah, we're finding other products that are very similar to yours in terms of the toys, but your competitors have better quality than you do. Their products are more durable. Children can bang them around and they withstand the beating up a little bit better. And that's one of the things we look at toys for. And you're charging an average of $5 per toy. So you're saying that you think this is a customer saying to you. So you think you've got top quality at bottom pricing? No. We get these out of Mexico, Israel, Brazil, wherever, and their quality is actually better than yours. Their toys are more durable. They just look better. And their price is about 10% below you. Okay? Now suddenly you don't have a strength. Think about it. That basically says your quality and your price is not a strength. And you very well may have been operating that whole time. But until you go out and do some research, hint on your project, if you go out and do some research and talk to the customers about your product and your ideas, you'll find out what are your strengths and weaknesses. So in this case, they may say, your quality and your price is not a strength. In fact, it's a weakness. Because so many producers have better quality than you. So many producers have pricing that's lower than you, anywhere from 10 to 20% less. That is a weakness on your part. Mr. and Mrs. Supplier, so you're wrong. Opportunities and threats. Think of the market. Every company exists within a market of competitors, manufacturers, customers, blah, 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 of companies that sell toys to Target. They sell in a world in which there's other toy manufacturers. They sell them in a world where there's Walmart, Target, Kmart, Best Buy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You also operate in a world of laws. Go back to the first one, the chemicals. If you have antitrust laws, that's part of your environment. In that case, we were saying we have to be very careful on our market share or we will be considered to be illegal activity compared to the antitrust laws. Okay. The world of laws around us affected our business. Our competitors affect our business. Our customers and their customers. Because Walmart may say, okay, we want to buy more from you. Opportunity. We're buying $1 million a year of this specific toy from you, and we're giving you $1 million a year, and we put about 50 of these in every store that we have in the U.S. We would like to double that. So that we have 100 of your toys in every store across America, which means you're going to need double capacity and everything. Opportunity. Okay. Sometimes with every opportunity comes a threat. Rubbermaid. Years ago, Rubbermaid and Walmart had a little war, and Rubbermaid had become a major supplier of Walmart, and it magnified Rubbermaid sales to where they grew much faster than they thought they would have, and much faster than they even could have any other way, because Walmart was just so big that when they bought a little bit, it impacted other companies tremendously. Because you think about it, Walmart, if you look at statistics, Walmart is basically equivalent to like 10% of the national GDP by itself. So one company is about 10% of the GDP in the United States, plus or minus. 3%. I'll take that back. I apologize. I said 10 is 3% of the GDP, but that's a major size company. Okay, so let's say the Rubbermaid, we're going to expand the volume we buy from you. And we're going to put it in all of our stores, greater volume. And Rubbermaid gets all excited. This is really going to turn us around. It's really going to take us to the next level of size of the company, size of the competitor. It's going to change us. This applies completely. What an opportunity. We can now become the size of the company that we've wanted to be for years. Ding, ding, ding. Opportunity, opportunity, opportunity. All right, now Walmart's got Rubbermaid all over this portal, in every store, huge volume, and they suddenly say, you know, this is all we're going to pay you. Based on how much we're buying from you, we know that your cost per unit is declining because your plants are more efficient. So instead of paying you $3 a unit for these things, we're going to give you $2. And Rubbermaid realizes that would be unprofitable. Because we're selling to them at such a cheap price, if we reduce their price from $3 to $2, we'll make no profit, we'll have a loss. And they say, that's the price you're going to sell it to us. And if you won't sell it to us for the $2, we'll find someone that will. Threat. So in that one situation, you had the two sides of the coin. Opportunity for growth and volume, taking over more of the share of the world's toys of rubber sales. Threat. Walmart told you clearly, if you don't do it, here's what we're going to drop you and go to someone that will sell it to us for what we want. And probably could have found somebody. The result was, at some point in the near future after that, Rubbermaid was doing so poorly, coming on Newell, E-L-L Newell, and Rubbermaid merged to where Rubbermaid became a part of them. And then soon thereafter, Rubbermaid started shutting down plants and selling out parts. I mean, the company was destroyed by the threats. So when you are developing your marketing plan, think in terms of SWOT being really important. And you want to understand your strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats that confront you in your market as compared to your competitors in the perception or in the eyes of your customer. And this is a very simple statement right here. You are, as a business, you are nothing more or less than what your customers say you are. If your customers tell you your inferior quality, your higher price, your inferior service, you're undependable on shipping and delivery on time, that's what your market's saying. Now your people are telling you inside, we make a great product, we ship as quickly as we can, we make as quickly as we can, we buy the products or all materials as cheaply as we can, so that we can do these things for this company. But the customer tells you something different. What's right is what the customer says. You are what they say you are. That's why you need to get to know the customers and find out what they see as your strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Now, you come to your picture. So you got your visions, we have macro. You've got your goals or your objectives. You've done your SWOT analysis. So these are the big picture items in the marketing plan. So those kind of general framework in which you're headed to manage the business. Now you need to do things such as decide what target market you want to go after. Okay. Do I have an overhead camera? Let's say that you're selling this acid that's used in the phosphoric acid that you use in the manufacturing of cola, like Coca-Cola, Pepsi-Cola, cola. If you think about it, like selling a Sprite, they're not cola. I don't think the beer's a cola either. It's the products that have certain raw ingredients in them, like the acid, are considered the cola products. So you look at the world around you, and let's say this is the whole world, and you're saying, in this world, there are a lot of companies that manufacture colas. Some in the U.S., some in Mexico, some in South America, some in Eastern Europe, some in China, Eastern Asia. There's a lot of small companies, but we've got these two big companies. Called Coca-Cola and Pepsi. Okay. So now, as a company, you have said what your goals are. So think about it. You have your vision statement. You said what you're going to do. You've got your objectives. One of your objectives may be to say, we want a certain volume or we want a certain market share. Your SWOT analysis shows that you have a lot of strengths compared to your competitors and you have more efficient manufacturing, better service delivery, constant quality assurance, because not a lot of companies don't have that. What we have to offer to those who want to pay for it. All right. I would say I would much rather go after this target of Coca-Cola and or this target called Pepsi, because if you think about it, if I don't go after them, I'm going to have to go after dozens and dozens and dozens of others with those two. That's just one example. So in this case, your target market are the two largest cola manufacturing companies in the world. So that's going to give you greater efficiency. Leave the overhead up if you would for a minute. The other thing, when you think about your target market, it could be age groups. You may find out that people that are 5 years old to 18 years old have a certain volume. And 18 to 24 have another certain volume to set up. Other age groups, older age groups. There's no real distinctive measure. So, like your 20 to 24, maybe this size of the market. Your 30 to 32 might be this size of the market. And you say, wow, look at this. Really, if I can get the market from 5 to 24, I've got about half of the market. How much easier would it be for me to go for half of the market? Worrying about all these others, okay? So I've said I'm going to focus on Coca-Cola and Pepsi because they're the two largest producers, and then with them focusing on those two customer companies, I'm going to work with them to identify how we and Coca-Cola together target these age groups with our products. That's a target market. Now you're saying who you're going to go after. I'm going after the audience that's 5 to 24 years old that drink Coke and drink Pepsi. That's my target market. Bam. Sweet and clean. I know exactly what I'm trying to do as a company. Question from Jen. Hey Jen, if the monopoly is natural, perhaps where your product is unique, there is no competition, then a monopoly is perfectly legal. I cannot argue with that at all. The only thing I might say is a lot of times we have competition we don't think about. A lot of times you think you're unique. Very few ideas are really unique. And one thing you want to really do is say if you have an idea and it's a unique idea, you're the only person with the idea, and you're out on the market for a year or two, you are a monopoly in your eyes. A, I would say this, in that situation, it's going to be really easy for someone to come in and compete with you. All they have to do is tweak something a little bit different. Just add one little thing to the formula. Just change one little part of the design, and they can get their own patent or trademark. It's really, really easy for people to copy you legally. By doing it just a little bit differently, and then trademarking and patenting it and getting through the system. And another thing is a lot of people don't think in terms of how broad your customers or your competitors are. For example, colas. Okay. Your competitors are not just colas. Coca-Cola's product competitors are not just competitors. The Sam's Cola, Pepsi-Cola, they also have to face the fact that what are they? There's the beverage. They're a way of quenching my thirst. Okay, I can do that with water. Not necessarily, I mean mineral water. It doesn't have to be liquid, I mean vitamin-enhanced water or anything. It can be 7-Up. And a lot of things can quench thirst. So usually if you think in terms of what service or benefit does your product bring to the customer, typically, if you really think about it, you're going to realize that you do have competition. Rarely do you have an idea that is so unique that you're out there and nobody can touch you. I have a phone call. I have a phone call.
Yes, hello, my name is
Sherry. I'm sorry. Can you turn the phone down back there? Okay, try again, please. Hello?
Hello, my name is Sherry.
Hi, Sherry.
I'm really enjoying your class very, very much.
Oh, thank you.
And I've been doing my my reading, and I'm fascinated by all this stuff. But the thing that's concerning me is what you said at the beginning of class about research in. And since we don't have access to customer relationship management software systems, how are we going to do our research for our class project?
I'm really glad you asked that question. Use your imagination. I'm not saying you have to do a certain type of research. For example, I used to teach at Wichita State, and there was a group of four young ladies in my class, and they had an idea of buying mud from the Dead Sea and bringing it to the U.S. in 50-gallon drums and making it a liquid paste and selling it as a face cleanser and make a base also or something like that. And what they did is they just went out to a mall and just talked about it. Like 10 people, they just talked to 10 people in a mall. And I was a student at Wichita State, which is always an easy way to get into research. It's just that I'm a student at Cal State Dominguez Sales, and I take time to ask you a few questions about a research project I'm doing for school. That opens a lot of doors. You're not threatening people. You're not a telemarketer. So in that situation, a lot of people will be helpful to do to help you. So it depends on your product. Now, so if you've got a consumer product, you know, just go out and talk to your family what they think about the idea. Talk to some neighbors, talk to friends. Go to the mall and just talk to a few people if you're talking about a consumer type product. If you're talking about an industrial type product, your point is totally right. As a more of a challenge for you, what you can do is go into the library through your university webpage. Instead of clicking on an email, you can click on a library. And when you go into the library, if yours is like ours is in Fullerton, and I'll check this out this week to find out if it is or not, there is a tab that says databases. And one of them says ProQuest, ProQuest. So you're in the library webpage. And got all these words and phrases at the top of the list says databases, parentheses, ProQuest. Go in there and just play for research. You'll be amazed at what you can find. You can just type in like manufacturing cost of detergent or a body soap or something. Just play around in there and you'll start finding very quickly what words you can use to help you find the knowledge that you're looking for in terms of research. You can find out a lot. You can go to like Procter & Gamble's annual report and very quickly figure out roughly what kind of profit margin they're making per unit. It tells you what their sales per year were. It tells you what your profit per year were. Well, just divide it out. And it says in general, this is the kind of profit margin that they operate on, in general, on average. And you can get to that through ProQuest database. So try that one for business to business. If your idea is business to business, I would suggest that you do that one. If your idea is consumer product, I'd go talk to a few people. And doing research, one thing you're going to find is you don't have to go out and talk to 100 or 1,000 people. For some reason, a lot of people have this image. If I'm doing market research, I have to talk to 10,000 people. No, you're going to be amazed within 3 or 4 people how much knowledge you have.
That is really helpful. Thank you so much.
Oh, my honor. Thank you for calling. It's a pleasure to talk to you. Bye-bye. Okay, Teresa, given that people stay in companies for a very short time these days, 10 years is a long time now. How would you create goals that are time specific, knowing that you probably won't be there for that long? And which employees would then need to know the business strategy? And whose responsibility it is to provide that information? Wow, that's a great question. And a very realistic question. Most people do change. That comes from the top down. If your company is going to look at things on a 10-year basis or a 5-year basis or a 2-year basis, that's a top-down decision. chairperson, the presidents, executive vice presidents of marketing, executive vice presidents of strategic planning, brand management, sales directorship. The top is where the decisions are made and how long you're going to look into the future. And typically what you're going to find out is they're going to develop the system of what they expect in your strategic plan. They're going to make it very clear what you're looking for from you for getting. So that's not one of those things that you have to waffle around with. Your company will make it very clear. This is the time frame we want you to think about. So I wouldn't worry about that one. Michael, in your Walmart example, tail wag the dog and Rubbermaid lost. I remember when I did that deal, I was buying for a wholesale distributor and Rubbermaid stopped selling me to take care of Walmart. Then when they had trouble with Walmart, they tried to come back to me on bended knee. But I'd already moved on. They may have been better off staying with a smaller segmented market. Very good. I'll give you another example. I'm sure we'll say something in trouble for putting my mouth. I'm sure you offered a flask of pickles. Several years ago, there was a little situation arose. And my these are just rough. I don't remember the specifics. It's been too long since I've read the case study on it. But it was very public, so I'm not telling you secrets. It's public information. Walmart told, my understanding is that Walmart kind of set a price goal for Vlasic. We want a price market point of this size. I think it was like a whole pickle unsliced, where it would be a jar for like $2 or $5, something like that. And Vlasic hesitated. They're like, no, that will hurt our other business. They're like, the arguments went back and forth, and they were saying, like, well, no, it won't hurt your other business if people are buying sliced pickles from Vlasic. They're not buying whole pickles. So the people who buy the whole pickle will be a totally new market segment that won't hurt your regular business. And if you can't do it, we'll find someone who can. Well, guess what? Lo and behold, within the next year or two, people did start switching from Vlasic sliced pickles to Vlasic whole pickles unsliced. And then Vlasic went bankrupt because they were selling pickles for less than their cost. So sometimes you're right, Michael, that's a good point. Don't always assume you want to go after the big dog. It's easy to say, oh, I want to be with the biggest customer. And I've done that myself when I was in sales years ago, and I'm talking about the companies. But I mean, I would go after certain ones. I would really build a relationship with certain companies, and I would get my business in these four or five big companies. What I did was I got myself at really high risk. If I had lost one of those, it would take me dozens of small ones to make up the difference. So, I mean, I was always, you know, really hustling to make sure those four or five big customers were extremely happy with everything, that there was nothing not covered to them. In retrospect, I might have added along the way a few smaller ones in case I lost a big one that I could have somebody there to fill it in with. So you're right, big dog's not always the best dog. So if we go to the next slide, go back to that slide, the marketing plan element slide, okay? You're both talking about, so now you've got your vision statement, you've got your goals, you've done your SWOT analysis, your target market strategy, who you're going to go after. For example, that case where I said, I'm going to go after people from 18 to 24, and I'm going to go after people in that age group that drink Pepsi and Coke. That was my target market strategy. Now, you need to have your market mix decisions, goals, okay? Product, promotion, price, and it used to be plus, which is for the distribution. They always talk about the four P's of marketing. I'm sure your book talks about it more times than I can count. But these are usually what are the components of marketing that you have to make product decisions. That means product volume, product quality, product efficiency, or whatever. Promotion, are you going to promote, for example, buy one, get one free, or are you going to advertise, or have special day coupons or something? Your distribution, how are you going to make sure that your product gets to your customers? customers, i.e. you sell things to them, something you move the laptops with, or be you selling your things to Target for them to have for their customers. That's all distribution is. How are you going? You need to figure out how well, how often, etc. you need to have products at the competitor, at the customer's places when they want them. Now you have a strategy of how you're going to do that. Like, I may use just one major shipping company and become such an important part of their business that they'll take care of all my shipments. Price, margin, profit. And what's your strategy? High price, low price. The market loves how to do things like that. Then the last part of your strategy is you always need to be coming back on a periodic basis, maybe 6 months, a year, whatever, and you need to be evaluating what you've done and see how that compares to what you wanted to do to see if you need to make adjustments on the way. That is a marketing strategy plan. Simple. This one really boiled down. That's it. Bear with me one second. Michael asked the question, the next one goes after. If we could go to the marketing objective slides. Michael asked some questions. Yes, Michael, you're right. Your goals need to be realistic, pragmatic. If I come to you, my boss, you're my boss, and I think, you know, I think I can take my share of the business in my market from 10% share to 30% share in 6 months, whatever. That's not realistic. Measurable. Profits. We want a 10% profit margin. That's very measurable. 10 times specific. We want to have a 10% market share in 10 years. Specific. So when you do your plan, your marketing plan, your goals have got to be specific, measurable, realistic, and consistent with what you do. If your company isn't capable of being a major player for whatever reasons, then don't say our goal is to be a major player. You have to be realistic about what you can do as compared to your capabilities, your human employee capabilities, your factory manufacturing capabilities, your import-export capabilities. You have to look at the laws that affect your business. You have to look at everything in terms of saying, okay, can we do what we want to do given this situation? Laura, I was told early on in my sales career that it's better to sell dumb to the masses than dumb to the classes. I can't argue with that one at all. I really can't. That is a really good phrase. I like that a lot. Can we go to the next slide? I think what we're going to do, we're starting to run down on time. I'm really communicating with you what I wanted to on the marketing strategy. The next 2 or 3 slides is from Blackboard. Basically, how to just rehash a little bit. Then you're going to be reading that chapter anyway. So, just know that I think right now that I've given you the meats of the bone to help you develop a marketing strategy plan. If anybody has any questions, remember just always send me an email and I'll help you figure out whatever information you need or whatever. I'm going to switch topics a little bit, and then we've got 18 minutes left. So, we're going to go to the topic of competitive advantage, which is slide 10. A good company, should have something about itself that gives it an advantage over the competition. What does Walmart offer you compared to the competition? What is their competitive advantage? Well, speed that you'd want is at Walmart. The prices overall are, on average, you know, the low price. They used to say the lowest of the low. So you can pretty much be guaranteed you can have a great selection of volume, find what you want at really good prices at Walmart. Target, a little different situation. If you want to go into a mass merchandiser that where, you know, the shelves are always organized and clean and everything's priced properly, you see the price of the products and everything, those are the things that Target wants to accomplish to make them be a little different from some of the other big box companies. So when I say big box, I'm talking about Walmart, Kmart, Target, etc. There's big boxes. If you, as a company, don't have something that gives you an advantage over your competition, your ability to really stand out and achieve your goals is reduced. If you really think about it, there's really very, very few things that you can really do that can give you a true unique advantage over the competition. Cost. You can make sure that you have the efforts taken regarding everything, and your strategies are giving you a cost per unit, cost to manufacture something, that your cost will be less than anybody else on the market. All right, that gives you the ability to go out there and really rule the market. Carnegie, who was kind of started the steel industry in America, I think I remember this correctly, it was Carnegie. Andrew Carnegie, who started ended up U.S. Steel, Kalanov Corporation in the early 1900s, especially. He always had a goal that he wanted his cost of manufacturing steel to be 20% less than his competition. His theory was, as long as I have that cost advantage, I can always beat my competition. That doesn't mean I'm going to go out and automatically sell cheaper, but it means there's no competition I have that can take me on and beat me in the long run. I'll wear them out and I'll bankrupt them. So that was his strategy, was to have a 20% lower cost per unit than anybody else. And he literally said, if I can do that, I'll always win in the marketing war. Can you really make your products different? Can you really do that makes your product different from the competition? And that will be a differentiating point on the long term. In other words, if you say our difference is we have a patent and a trademark that cover everything about our product that nobody else can make it for 20 years, such as Johnson & Johnson pharmaceutical products or Merck pharmaceutical products, they protect what they've got, the differences that they have, they protect as long as they can, because that enables you to charge customers a little more, and enables you to make sure you keep the customers. So those two come all hand in hand. Cost, lower cost, enables you to have more money to spend on making your products different than your competition. Doesn't mean you have to or you will, it just gives you that capability. And niche. Target. What target are you going after? Be specific. Think in terms of, okay, I'm going after this 18 to 24-year-old Coca-Cola, Pepsi-Cola drinker market, and that's the niche I'm going after, and here's what I'm going to do to go after that target. Very specific. Generally, for the most part, you can have advantages on those three areas. But as you think about, you always need to make sure that you can maintain these differences on the long term. Let's go to the last slide. Slide number 16. Or 94. It says review learning outcome. That's good. I'm going to mess things up here. So we can use the system since we don't have something this great of a fuller than at all. When you boil everything we've talked about down today, what I'm really saying is take time to develop some goals. Then take time to develop some strategies for your price, your product, your quality of your product. Are you going to have those expensive products, the cheapest product, or the best? best quality product that's at a higher price. Promotion, have a strategy for how you're going to get your product out there to the market and get the market buying your product. Price, distribution, any strategies for each of these to achieve your goals. That means you always have to be examining, did we meet our objectives? And it goes back to some of those questions about short, specific questions or specific time frame of projects. So if I imagine this is a bar chart on years, I want some way, every 6 months or something, some way to constantly check, are we meeting our objectives? Do we need to make changes? This is where you got your ego go in business. Forget your ego, leave it at home, don't bring it out the door with you. Good business people are always willing to say when they've made a mistake and need to go back and make some corrective action. They may, for example, have said, well, now that we've been doing it a while, we realize we can't make the best product that is in every store shelves on the day they need it, etc. And have a 2-for-1 promotion strategies and have a lowest price. That's not practical. So when you're examining things, examine what you achieved, and then go back and compare it to what were your specific goals along the way. That is what will tell you whether you need to change or not change. Make the people that do the examination as independent as possible. If you can afford to hire consultants to do it, that's great, because they don't have anything vested in it. Employees at a company, you're vested, you're at the risk that if you don't tell the manager what they want to hear, sometimes they get upset with you. So the more independent the people that do the examination, the better it can be. And systematic on a regular basis, periodic. I'm just really saying, after you've put together your marketing plan, always develop it such that it's something which you can come back and re-examine, review, challenge, and then you need to do that. And a lot of times, ego gets involved. If it's a private owned company, the owner, you know, thinks nothing, he can do nothing wrong, he or she can do anything wrong. So throw the ego out and be willing to do it. I think you're going to have a great marketing plan that will help you achieve your goals. There was two more slides I wanted to chat about. We do have a couple more minutes here. Realism is like 11 is in strategic alternatives. And this is something I haven't talked about, but now that we do have time, I want to bring it to your thoughts. Okay, strategic alternatives. Okay. What is it you want to achieve in the market? This isn't getting into some of the other things you were talking about. This is a point you need to get into with your strategy. And this is not really something talking to the customers about in all interviews or online surveys or whatever. You usually, as a company, have certain things that you can do. For example, market penetration. Increase market share among existing customers. Okay. I'll give you an example of that. When I was a themselves with FMC. There is a company in Pittsburgh called Calcon. And this will move through enough. These things are like bath oil beads, florals and bath oil beads. And they use phosphates in them to make the water soft and everything. They were owned by the giant German company called Bayer. Well, we had a wonderful, always had a wonderful relationship with Calcon, wonderful company, awesome people, and just a wonderful relationship. Couldn't have been any better. And then we started finding out about some of their other business units. And lo and behold, we found out that their company had other businesses that used similar raw materials and manufactured their products. So we were able to get into some of the other parts of the company and increase our sales within that company. We were penetrating deeply into that particular buyer company out of Germany, and it was really becoming a major. It was really easier to get to be a bigger share of an existing customer's business. Like when we worked on Pepsi and getting their business, at one time we were like 0%. We had done their business, and we went to eventually we had 100% of the domestic business for the the acid went into the syrup concentrate. We went from 0 to 100. And so each step along the way, we were penetrating that business segment, our business customer, getting more and more and more of their business every step we took. And it was just great. It was wonderful, a way to grow. Now, with that comes responsibilities. Anybody said, okay, I want to penetrate the market. I want to have more and more of the business that my current customers have, because rarely companies give you 100%. They may hit 5 or 6 or 7 or 10 suppliers of the same thing, and they think they're diversifying their risk, and they may not want that. They want just one or two suppliers. But if you can be such a marketer and have programs and products and strategies and everything that enable you to get them to be willing to just have you and or possibly one other supplier, you're growing your business through your current customers. It's great. That's probably the number one thing I ever did to grow my sales. I mean, it was always success, not luck. Nobody trained me that. I just have to get the idea. Nothing more than a dumb luck that I realized the value of that one. And later on, it just really, really paid off. Okay. Sometimes you need to get new customers, especially for a smaller company or a startup company. They don't have that many customers. So maybe if you have small customers, well, then you need to go out and get some more customers. So sometimes it can be growing with a customer or growing by adding new customers. All right, products. Sometimes you need new products. That acid that was used in the studies I talked about, also used, I'm not sure if it's used or not, it used to be used in a bath by Intel. When they were making chips, they made computer chips, and they were going to this bath to clean them off. Well, that was important because the cleaner and more pure the computer chip, the better it could run. And this is, show you my age, this was before the pre-gigabit time. This was way before they got into gigabits. We found out through working with them and their guidance and everything, different product, a different kind of acid that was more pure and had fewer impurities in it, that they could speed up their chips. And that's because certain things were in our acids, such as phosphate salts, sodium salts, magnesium, iron, lead, arsenic, extremely minute particles, like, you know, trivial parts per million, so I mean, no way can hurt you. But that would lay or end up depositing a layer on the chip and would rot the chip or enable it to not achieve its goals of efficiency, volume of storage, and everything. Let me go to a question. I'm going to go right out of time. I'm rambling. Yamuna, how is creating a marketing plan for an existing product that you're looking to enter a new market segment different than creating a marketing plan for a new product that you're looking to enter market segment? So basically, you're asking, go back to the beginning of the question. So basically, you're question is, if I'm developing a marketing plan for an existing product, would I do that differently than creating a marketing plan for a new product?
No.
I do the same. If I was starting a business with nothing right now more than a thought in my head, I would want to go out and develop a marketing plan to help me start understanding, is this project feasible and viable? If I have an existing company, I'm wanting to say, okay, I have goals. Are those goals viable? You're always trying to figure out, are my ideas going to survive and be successful? Can I achieve my goals, be a viable business, and be the type of business I want to be? When it really boils down to it, that's what you're after. No, there's nothing I would do differently between an existing company and a startup. So as we go on for the rest of the semester, what we're going to do each week is we're going to get into more specific topics that you can use in your marketing plan. We'll get into pricing sometimes. We'll get into quality control sometimes. So that's what I'm trying to do, is I want you to come out of this class understanding how to make a marketing plan. So if you're an accountant or a finance person or manufacturing, sometime, someway, somehow, you will end up working with other people on marketing plans and adding your own knowledge. Have a great weekend. Hope a great one to rest. And here we go. I'll see you next week. Bye. Thank you.